Get ready. Right there. My glove just touched him right there. That's the first touch from human hands he's had on him. Good boy. Drive him away a little bit. Go get control of his feet a little bit. Every time he lets me up here, I'm going to loosen this rope up here. That's my boy. My method works real good on horses. It does not work on women, camels, or kids. Okay, mate, it's day two of a challenge, and we're continuing on our training. So we finally decided to name him, and we're going to call him Bundy, which is short for Bundaberg Rum. Because during the day, we're doing chasing wild horses around the outback, taming them, showing them the method. At nighttime, we drink Bundaberg Rum, which is Australia's most famous rum. In America, I drink Captain Morgan. In Australia, I like to drink Bundaberg Rum. How I was conceived on it. My parents never would have got together without it. Okay? So we're just going to call him Bundy. Good boy.
Down Under Horsemanship's Australian Outback Adventure is brought to you by Ritchie Industries. Fresh water for life.
I'm Clinton Anderson, and I have a method for training horses. Getting horses to behave is simple. It's training people that's the real trick. Join me as I tackle some of the most challenging situations with problem horses and with problem owners.
So what I've done is I've put my plastic bag on the end of my stick, because what I want to do now is I just want to start moving him around. But while I'm moving him around, I'm also be desensitizing to something he's going to be a little worried about. So I'm going to go back and yield that hindquarters. This is kind of like a mild version of lunging stage one, lunging for respect stage one. Yield that hindquarters away, two eyes. Just go move his feet around. That's it. Yield. 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 See, the halter gives you a lot more leverage. Yield. 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 Yield, two eyes. I'm gonna take my gloves off now because I can get a little better feel of the rope without them. It's mainly that lariat you wanna have these gloves for so that they don't give you real bad rope burn.
Remember, mate, there's three ways you can control a horse's mind: creating movement, redirecting movement, and inhibiting movement.
So all I'm trying to do now is just kind of pull on him a little bit and just get him giving her that halter, two eyes, learning how to yield to it, move him off, creating movement, and now watch, redirecting the movement. Creating, redirecting, redirecting. This is with the halter. And get more leverage on their nose. Two eyes.
To get more control of his mind and get him to use the thinking side of his brain, I did a lot of kind of chasing him off and healing his hindquarters. The more I start changing directions, the more control I get, respect, and him using the thinking side of his brain.
See, I'm kind of nagging him with the bag. So I want him to get a little dull to it here. Even though I want him to move, at some point he's gonna quit moving from the bag. He's gonna say, you know what? That bag's not real scary. I don't need to move from it. And that'd be just fine with me. So he'll slowly start coming off this fence more. Not be so not be leaning on the halter so much. That's a boy. Yield that hindquarters. That's it. I'm using the fear of the bag to move his feet. And at the same time, he's just gonna start to get duller and duller to the bag. See how he stopped trotting now? He started to walk a little bit. That's because he's starting to get a little desensitized to the bag. That's what I'm looking for. If he wants to walk and relax, I'll let him. I'll start to pull and release on the halter just a little bit here. Start to get him to, there, I like that yield. See how he's starting to relax a lot more? I'd like him just to walk if he will. But I can't make him do that. He's just gotta relax enough to let it happen. With the plastic bag, he started moving slower around me in a circle. He started to get some more arc to his body where he's giving to the halter. As your horse starts using the thinking side of his brain, you'll notice that they'll soften up their body parts and won't be so stiff and rigid. Watch my right hand. Every time he leans on that halter, I pull on it, then I release it. Pull on it, then I release it. And I yield. So not real exciting stuff right now, but this is kind of like the alphabet for horse training. This is the basics. If he can't do the basics, he's not gonna be able to do anything more advanced. I got it. I don't want him to be frightened of me or my tools. Now I like that time. That time he just kind of walked off. That's a good sign. See the slack in the rope here a little bit? That's a good sign too. Yield the hindquarters. I'd like to get him to where he don't want to run away from this bag at all. Horses hate objects that move and make a noise. Okay, so if he wants to move, that's fine, but I'm not gonna make him move. I'm not gonna make him move. You can see him just getting more relaxed all the time. This is the inspiration of this series.
Tired of dumping and scrubbing dirty buckets and tanks? Dread breaking ice this winter? Sick of wasting precious water and even more precious time? Then it's time to change the way you water. The industry leaders in horse products and watering have teamed up to bring you a fresh idea on watering. Introducing Classic Equine by Richie. Fresh water on demand is critical to horse health. Automatic waterers ensure it stays cleaner, so your horses drink more and you waste less. So kick the bucket and the tank. When you choose from options such as multi-head heated and insulated pasture units to premium corner-mounted stall founts. And only Classic Equine by Richie offers a garden hose hookup unit for easy installation. Classic Equine by Richie makes automatic watering the only way to go for the ease of horse owners and the health of the horse.
So this is real good here. He has decided to stand still by himself. I have not tried to make him go. So I took something that was scary to him and was starting to teach him that he don't need to be worried about it. Notice that I'm always standing at a 45 degree angle to him. There we go. So now he's kind of looking for a little bit of a rest. Okay, so I want to show him that when he's out of air, I'll let him stop and I'll rub on him. Me rubbing on him now is the desensitization. I'm going to sensitize him to pressure, and I'm gonna desensitize him to pressure. You need to do both. I gotta get back there eventually to where I can get the saddle on him, put a saddle pad. So I'm rubbing his neck here. He's a little nervous. I'm just gonna stay here until he relaxes a little bit, and I'm gonna retreat. So now that was a desensitizing exercise. Let's go back and sensitize. I'm gonna try to scare him off. If he goes, great. If he doesn't, that'd be fine too, but then I just use something else to move him off. Move the hindquarters, move the forequarters. Now let's move on to lunging stage two. I'm gonna get more control of his front end. I'm gonna step out in front of him, move that head, neck, and shoulder now. I wanna get control of both ends of my horse, back end and the front end. Now anytime he goes to walk and relax on the circle, I'm gonna let him do that. So I'm gonna step out in front now of the drive line. The drive line's right where his neck joins his shoulder, okay. So I'll use the fear of the bag to the point where he doesn't want to move away from the bag. Then I'll have to use another tool to make him move. But I don't want to hit him with the bag or hurt him with it to where I give him a reason to be frightened. Yeah, I like that when he walks and relaxes. Step in front of the drive line, point up high, move that front end. He's dropping back to a walk a lot quicker now, isn't he? He's started to figure out he can be lazier with this. Step out in front of the drive line, point. Yeah. And normally I want a real snappy turn, energetic turn, but with him, because he's been really fearful of humans, I don't care if he does a real lazy kind of relaxed turn. In fact, I'd prefer that, at least for the next day or two. See how he's getting to the point he's gonna quit me again? I'm gonna let him quit me right there. Okay. Right then, he decided to stop by himself. So I'm gonna take advantage of that. If he wants to stop, I'm gonna take advantage of that. I'm gonna just start flapping it all over his body here a little bit. So if he's gonna give me the green light and let me go rub him with the stick, I'm gonna go ahead and do that. The most important thing you can do as a horseman is understand how crucial it is to release pressure at the right time. A little bit cautious on his shoulder here. I want to make sure the bag stays on the same side of his body I'm on. If the bag gets on the other side of his spine, he looks back at it, he might kick me. I'm gonna start rubbing his head here a little bit. Their head, under their belly, and their legs are the sensitive parts of a horse that they're frightened of the most. Once you can flap that plastic bag around the horse's head and he can relax and stand still and not be frightened, you'd be amazed how much more quieter they get. But you don't want to start the head too early, and you've got to do it in stages like I'm doing here. I'll move with him if he gets a little frightened. Just kind of move with him. Just move with him. Just kind of drift with him a little bit. I don't want him to feel like he's trapped here, because then he might start fighting more, start striking out at this. There, he's starting to relax. Just because Bundy's getting quieter and more desensitized, don't think for a second he couldn't hurt you or kick you in the face. So again, keep your wits about you when you're working with a wild horse, because they're extremely reactive. Kind of kept his head still, so I retreat and rub him. That's a big step, you know. 2 days ago, he was a wild Brumby out in the middle of the outback, 10 years old, okay? Now he's letting me flap him with a plastic bag. It's a big step. Now he's licking his lips, but notice how his head's still up in the air. I'm gonna wait till he relaxes a little bit more. I'd like him to have a half hour break just to mentally and physically just relax and just digest some of these lessons. Oh, I like that. He's licking his lips there, yawning. Okay, bring him up to me here a little bit. Right, now what I'm gonna do is just leave him in the pen. I'll give him a bucket of water. Okay, So now I'm directly in front of him, rubbing him, and I'm not too worried about him striking me now. Normally I tell people don't do this, and that's true in the beginning. But as you start to develop their confidence and you're not worried about them, then you can start putting yourself in different positions. Now it's very important now that I walk away from him. He didn't leave me, I left him. Let's give him some water and half hour break.
Horsemanship's Australian Outback Adventure is brought to you by Ritchie Industries. Fresh water for life.
Rightio, so we've given him a little break here for the last 30 minutes. I want to change lead ropes here and put this 14-foot line on him. The reason why I want to put this one on him is it's not quite as much rope to carry around, a little less awkward. And I just don't need this long one as a general rule. I might put it on from time to time with specific exercises. So what I want to do now is just start getting more control of his feet, okay? So I'm going to go in here and yield this hindquarters some more, okay? Except now I'm going to try to get a little bit of bend to his head here. Yield this body a little bit. Now I'm going to move his front end through, okay? So now it's just a lot of moving his feet forwards, backwards, left and right. So I'm gonna yield his hindquarters, twirl my end of my rope towards his hip, lift my hand up in the air a little bit, and I wanna start getting some bend through his body. Because when I go to saddle him, I wanna be able to bend his head and neck. Before I get the saddle out, I gotta get more control of his feet, forwards, backwards, left and right. That's how you gain a horse's respect and get them to use the thinking side of their brain. And I've also got to get in closer to him. I've got to be able to get in beside him more, okay? Well, I've got to ease in there. If he can't accept me, he won't accept my tools. Now I'm going to take him over here to this fence, practice a little bit of the sending exercise on him. Send him between me and that fence. Horses hate tight, narrow spaces. So this will help get him used to that. I'm not gonna get in real close to the fence in case he tries to kick me. Okay, yield. Point. That's it. Now the reason I'm using the end of the rope a little bit at this point rather than my stick is because I wanna get him used to things swinging around him. So I'm kind of moving his feet, but at the same time, get him not so overreactive about my rope. Ask him with the halter, tell him with the rope. What do I mean by that? Point, I've asked him here, look, I've asked for his feet to move. If they don't, I use the end of a lead rope. You'll notice pretty early on, I want to start teaching Bundy the sending exercise, because the sending exercise gets the horse coming off that halter pressure on his pole, on his jaw. It also gets better control of the horse's hindquarters, and it gets the horse used to going through what? Tight, narrow spaces.
Pushier as well.
Very important exercise to teach any horse.
It's crucial.
I want respect without fear. If you get the fear out of the horse, next thing you know, they'll be disrespectful. You've got to have both. You got to have respect without fear. Two eyes. Radio. Well, this is the craziest thing so far. Not quite the craziest. The bull catching was the craziest so far, but this is something that Ian schemed up, and I don't know if he's pulling our leg on this deal or what it is, but we're gonna be capturing camels today.
You're one team, and these two of the second team.
So I'm gonna be in the back of the bull catcher with a rope on a stick, which is the Australian version of roping, okay?
Clinton's gonna be riding up here, and this is Clinton's rope, this one here. It's on a stick, because he's pretty useless with the lariat, so I thought I'd put it on a stick.
So we're gonna tear after these wild camels.
We'll have to run these camels around until Clinton makes a selection of the camel that we wanna catch.
What kind of camel am I looking for?
You're looking for a good one, a good looking one, mate.
What constitutes a good looking
nice
camel?
Nice big lips, big eyes, long eyelashes, you know, beautiful, yeah.
All right. I put the rope over the camel's neck, and then once that's done, I jump off the bull catcher.
Once Clinton's caught this camel with this rope here, we'll stop the Toyota.
I jump out.
You jump out very quickly. One of your men will jump out with a long rope. That's got to be stretched right out.
Me, Rick, and Ken grab one end of the rope, and David and Junior get on the other end, and Edric. And we all swap and we all race around the camel, okay? One to one direction, one the other direction.
The knockdown is where you cross over one another.
We're gonna go over.
You're gonna go over and they're gonna go under, so yep. You gotta go around twice. Pull the rope up tight, it's gotta be above the knees. Mm-hmm. Pull it up tight and the camel will sort of stagger and then it'll fall over.
Do we help it fall over or
no.
not? It will fall over
it
by
will
itself.
Fall over. It might take a couple of seconds, but it will fall over naturally.
And we basically gotta get the rope above the camel's knees. And we keep pulling it tighter and tighter until the camel falls over.
Then as soon as it falls over, everybody's got to be on it, otherwise it'll get back up.
And then apparently, I don't know how I got roped into this job, but once it hits the ground, the next important thing is to get the camel's head on the ground.
You're going for the head?
Right.
You can have Rick give you a hand with the head.
Right.
The rest of them will actually sit on the hump, mm-hmm. on its side.
And then Ian gets out when all the dangerous shit is already done. And then he ties all its legs up. And apparently this is camel chasing, camel catching in the outback, okay?
Once it's in a natural sitting position, it'll just kick back up and sit there as though it's having a rest.
This is probably the stupidest thing I've done so far, but we're gonna see how it works out. And what about the camel biting me?
Oh, look, don't worry about that. We've got the flying doctor on standby, so you'll be okay, mate.
I've seen these camels bite, and I've heard them tell me that if a camel gets a hold of your arm, it can break your arm or break your leg. They can bite really hard, and they're real powerful. So I'm not sure how I got roped into the actual jumping on the head part. The hump part actually sounds a hell of a lot safer. But anyway, I'm here now, so we're gonna give it a shot.
We'll be right back with more from the Australian Outback, presented by Ritchie Industries.
World-renowned horseman Clinton Anderson is famous for his easy-to-understand method that gets results immediately with any horse. Now, you can get the ultimate tutorial of his method in a complete kit. Introducing Downunder Horsemanship's Fundamental Series. Clinton Anderson's signature method is packed with more practical training tools than any on the market today. He details his 8 steps to success, a dynamic and progressive format that makes even the most advanced maneuvers easy to understand and apply. The Clinton Anderson Fundamental Series kit includes 14 instructional DVDs with over 28 hours of brand new footage. Ground fenning, groundwork, and riding topics are explored in greater depth and with more useful techniques than ever before. 15 arena mates containing step-by-step illustrations of the DVD lessons in handy pocket-sized booklets you can take to the barn and arena. Plus, you'll get Clinton's beautiful, perfect-bound philosophy book containing over 100 pages of insight and explanation of his method. This complete guide to the fundamentals of Clinton's training method comes packaged in a handy carrying case. Altogether, that's over $800 worth of training innovation, inspiration, and instruction. Now you can get the most in-depth horse training tutorial available for only $5.99. And if you're a No Worries Club member, the kit is yours for only $3.99. That's over $400 in savings. So act now. Restart your training program with all the latest tools for success with the Clinton Anderson Fundamental Series. To order, call or click 1-888-AUSSIE-2 or www.downunderhorsemanship.com.
One of the things that helped us to progress in this part of the world was camels. I saw a market in camels. I'd got this contract with this American buyer to make some money. By the time the camels got back to the States, they run into about $10,000-$12,000 a head to land them in the States. So that was a very, very, very good contract for us because we were the only suppliers for a long period of time. And so if you look at most of the camels in the United States today, I think that the original ancestors of those camels came from here, right where we're sitting in this region here now. Camels came in when the first explorers started to move around this country. By 1900, they were coming in droves, and there was about 10,000 camels in Australia by the turn of the century, 1900. And camel trains were very common here in the early days, carrying goods to all of Outback Australia. And one bull camel was capable of carrying between 600 and 800 kilos on its back. Thereafter, a lot of the camels were just turned loose, and for a period of time, about 10 years, camels had no use whatsoever. So during that time, they just went bush everywhere and they bred up in large numbers all over the place. The experts tell us that we've got somewhere in the vicinity of about a million camels here in Australia, just roaming wild in the deserts. I still catch camels today, and I catch them for all sorts of markets. Camels are a very difficult animal to try and catch because they live in the open country around Central Australia, and you can't just go out and hope to catch them willy-nilly. Some of the bull camels tower over to, 2.5 metres high, and they weigh in at anywhere between 600 and 1200 kilos, so they're a very big animal. Australian camels are mainly one colour. They're the camel colour, the normal colour, as everyone calls it, a camel colour. We do have black ones and we do have white ones, but that's pretty unusual. We make camel sausages, camel hamburgers, camel jerky, camel bacon. We cook them for roast. You know, any cut that you get out of beef, we can make out of camels. One of the unique things that the scientists have discovered is that camels have a unique bacteria in their stomach, and it's very well recognised in Australia today, in that this bacteria helps them break down practically any plant that they put into their stomachs. They're very big, strong animal. They knock down fences and yards and stuff like that. And so, you know, very powerful animal that don't take too much notice of a lot of things that are in front of them. Not that they're blind or stupid or anything, but nothing gets in their way because they feel superior to everything that they're around.
And that big black bull. Yep, that's him.
Which one?
I had no idea that there was that many feral wild camels in the middle of Australia. You know what was really interesting to me is the amount of feed and vegetation that the camels eat. I noticed that all the treetops are all kind of like cut off, and that's because the camels eat all those leaves and branches from up high.
That other one's got a green tag in his ear.
Well, I can't see which one you want.
This one here.
Camel don't have hooves as such. They have feet, like your soft feet. They have toes. And when they walk on the ground, their feet actually flatten out.
He's a lot faster too.
I see him, green tag. This one, green tag. Green tag right here to the left.
No, I don't want it that big. Yep, that's it. No, that's a cow. We want that one there.
You can follow a herd of 80 head of camels or 100 head of camels and it'll be one straight pad. And you really can't count how many camels have gone across, except that bit of pad that they go down will be flattened because of the flat feet. It's like taking a roller in there. What Clinton's going to do is he's going to be riding on the back of my bull catcher. He's going to be using a rope off the back. Once he puts the rope over the head of the camel, the rope will tension up and it'll be attached to the bull catcher. And then as soon as he does that, he's got to get off the vehicle, get his men organised on the ground, to do a knockdown. We do the knockdown with a long piece of rope, which is a big zip around. It's sort of both teams come from opposite directions so that they can actually cross the rope around the legs twice and then pull it up tight until the legs all fold up and the camel will just fall down on the ground. Then Clinton needs to dive for the head. He's the head man. He's got to go over the top and hold the head down. And once he's on the head, he's actually got to duck right down too, because once the camel is on the ground, he's still a dangerous animal in that he can still kick you if you're sitting on the head. That leg can, from the back, can come right up. So you've got to duck down, and the other men will be on the hump by this time. And once they're holding it in that position, I'll get in and I'll tie the camel up in a natural sitting position, and the camel will sit back up in its sitting position, and that's the end of the story.
Halter, we got him, boys.
What we're going to do now is we're going to leave this camel here for a minute, or not a minute, about 20 minutes, let him settle down a little bit. Then we'll come back with a trailer, and we'll slide this camel onto the trailer, and we'll take it home. This is not a bad little camel that we can take home. And
how old's this one?
This one's about 18 months old. Yeah. Good age to start off with. We're breaking them in, you know? Thanks for that, Clint.
Good job.
You did a bloody good job, mate.
Thank you, fellas. Yeah. Did an awesome job. Good job, mate. Edric.
And you can't sit on them now, too, because they're, you know, not too bad. Yeah.
Right here. Good job, big fella.
Ah, pretty good team. No problems at all. Bloody good team.
I tell you what, that was a lot of adrenaline, that's for damn sure. A lot of fun, but I'm going to leave the camel catching to Ian from now on. I'm glad I've done it once. I had a good team around me. But I tell you what, you have to be on your game and you have to be right in there straight away. But that's a hell of a lot of fun, I can tell you that. Thing. Stay with him, boys. Stay with him, Rick.
Go, Rick. Go, Rick. Go, Rick.
You got it, Rick. Stay with it, boy. I love it. I'll see you back now with Rick.
Stay on. Come back, Rick.
Fresh water on demand is critical for your horse's health. Make sure it's always available when you install Ritchie Waters. We've got the model to suit your needs, whatever they may be. Get the most energy efficiency with the new Eco Fount series. Get the benefits of both steel and poly construction with the Omni Fount. Get the best combination of value and performance with the Watermatic. And for delivering water directly to your horse, there's our newly redesigned stall fount. Ritchie set the standard in quality when we invented the automatic waterer in 1921, and we've been the industry leader ever since. So when you buy a Ritchie, you know you're getting the most dependable product on the market, not to mention the best value, service, and warranty in the business. After all, water is essential. We make it easy.
Down Under Horsemanship's Australian Outback Adventure is brought to you by Ritchie Industries. Fresh water for life.
So now I'm going to come back, work on desensitizing the ropes. See how I'm not pulling off from a straight angle? Always in arcs. See how I'm trying to get him to the center of the pen, but I'm always arcing him there. Pick up and then release it. Never just walk straight off. Pull, pick up, release it. Pick up, release it. Good boy, something a little different. Each exercise is like a new tool in his tool bag. So now I'm gonna desensitize him to my rope. I'm gonna flip my rope over his back. So I wanna teach him, but he can have this draped over his body. He doesn't need to worry about it. This is a new stimulus. Until I can get this done, I can't get the saddle on him. So now I'm gonna do his back legs here. I'm gonna stand back just a little bit here in case he's kicking it. Like that. Okay. So I'm just, it's all right. He's not being bad. He's just being, this is new for him. In the wild, if an animal would grab him around the back leg, he'd kick at it. He's just doing what Mother Nature told him to do. When a wild Brumby does something, it's gonna happen quickly. They're not gonna give you a lot of warning. Now just then, he kind of licked his lips, started to relax. Okay, so now I'm getting in closer to him. See how I'm rubbing his rib cage here a little bit? See how I'm putting a little bit of bend in his neck here? Okay, now we'll do his front legs. Now I'll stand back a little further in case he strikes at this.
He didn't do anything. That's good. When he does really good, I'm going to retreat. But when I retreat, you're going to notice that I'm going to start putting a little more bend in his neck here. The more I bend his neck, the safer I am, because I can get that hindquarters, okay, to start moving away from me. Whatever way his nose is tipped, his butt will go the opposite way. So notice that I've got the hand on that rope, and I'm starting to desensitize him around his belly, aren't I? I'm starting to say, hey, get ready for this girth now. Get ready for this saddle, big fella. And the last thing I want to do is pitch the whole thing over his back. I love to throw things at my horse that are never going to hurt them. Remember, heart attacks are free, so give your horse one. The more you try to scare a horse, the quieter they get. The less you try to scare them, the spookier and jumpier they get. Hey, Bundy. I'm going to go and work on his leading a little bit. Loosen that rear end up. Anytime I get a chance, go back to that rear end. You cannot do too much of this with any horse, loosening up that hindquarters. And now spiral out. See, I let the rope slide through my hand a little bit. One step, two, three, four, five. There we go. Good boy. I want to start getting him a lot less jumpy around his head. He's real funny about his head still, more than what I'd like. So I want to get him to where he's quieter around his head. He's a little bit defensive, and he may be like that just because he's been in a fight and lost that ear, okay? But I want to get him to where I can move my hands and the rope around his head better, and he's not so defensive. That's better. That's it. That's it. Once you do that, now I'm going to turn it into another little exercise, okay? Just turn and yield. So I'm going to have it over his butt here a little bit. Now you probably get a little bit worried about this. Now I'm gonna step back. Just gonna pick up and hold it. Remember I said training horses about putting them in a bind and letting them figure it out? He's in a little bind now. He's gotta figure out how to turn and release that pressure from his neck. He's pushing into it. He's pushing into it. There's a little release right there. I'm gonna let him find it here. I might even step out the side just a little bit to help him here, okay? So he's gotta learn how to yield that hindquarters. Get ready. This is me steering him under saddle. If he doesn't know how to turn, good boy. That's the boy. Now I'm gonna walk up to him and rub him. He's gotta spend more time with me approaching him from the front. That's my boy. That head bent. Get him used to me rubbing on him here. Keep that head bent. Remember, bend is your friend. It'll keep you safe. You know, it's about 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and when I saddle them, I typically want to do it to where they can wear the saddle all day. I want them to wear it for a good minimum of 8 hours. Well, if I saddle him now, I'm going to have to take it off before it gets dark, okay? So I'm gonna wait and saddle him tomorrow. And by waiting, we can saddle him first thing in the morning, he'll be ready, and we can let him wear that saddle all day. Very important. You don't wanna put that saddle on for just a short amount of time. That's the quickest way to get a horse to learn how to buck with a saddle, is just put that saddle on for a short amount of time, okay? See, he's not as soft this way, is he? He's got to learn to give that neck a little bit more this way. There we go. See here? There, when he bends, I pull, watch. When he softens, I release it, just like that there. Rightio. Good boy, Bundy. It's a good place to quit him here. Now, what I'd like to do, just before I quit him, is practice putting this halter on. Okay, because tomorrow I'd like to have to not have to rope him to get him caught. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to put my rope on him and then take the halter off and practice that a few times.
Are you frustrated with your horse's lack of discipline?
or struggling with his lack of experience? Do you suffer from the lack of time it takes to turn the horse you have into the horse you really want? Well, there's a method for that madness. Send him to the Clinton Anderson Academy, and we'll turn your horse into an academy horse. The Academy trains only the best horsemen to share Clinton's methods with horse owners around the world as Clinton Anderson certified clinicians. Just as these top trainers enroll in the Academy, so can your horse. During the 6-week course, he will learn the entire fundamentals level of the method to be ridden in and comfortable with a full gamut of situations. At the Clinton Anderson Academy, we have the time, the experience, and the best training method to help you discover your horse's true potential. So stop the madness. Turn your horse into an academy horse.
So now what I want to do is just get him comfortable with me putting that halter on and off without having the rope around his neck first. But just for a little bit of guarantee that we're not going to get into a wreck, I'm going to put this over his neck just because kind of my insurance plan here. Now what I'm going to do is practice just approaching him and putting this halter on him. The last thing you do every day is the first thing I remember the next day. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to walk away from him and now just approach him again. Approach him and pretend I don't have this rope on his neck. Okay. Just get this halter over his head and just get him used to this here. And I'm going to take it off again. He's doing pretty good, so I might drop my rope there. I just want to practice this a few times because it's not the end of the world if I have to rope him tomorrow. But I'd prefer not to, okay? I'd prefer not to have to rope him. Every day, my horse should just get a little bit gentler. Every day. There we go. And then take that off and then retreat. I might be a little more obvious about it, just kind of hold it up like this, okay? Might try something a little bit different. Get this under his neck here. He's never had this done before. And then scoop his nose. Good boy. Good boy, Bundy. You're getting good, aren't you? So I've just got the rope on him as a little bit of insurance in case he got frightened or took off. I can get a hold of him pretty quickly. Rightio. Let's see what he's like now without the insurance policy. Righto, big fella. All right, you had enough for today? Bundy's done real good today. This is his second lesson. Tomorrow he'll be more than ready for the saddle. If it was a little earlier in the day, I'd just saddle him now. But we're running out of daylight to let him wear it for a good 8 hours though. He's licking his lips. Hey, buddy, you're doing great. Good boy.
So, Clint, how's this challenge going, old fella?
I think you're gonna get your with, mate. I think this is in the bag.
Mate.
You told me it had to be kid broke.
That's what I want to see. You haven't even got anywhere near that yet.
No.
You've got a few more days on this yet,
yes,
mate.
I have got a few more days on it, but yes. I think I'm going to get it kid broke, ready to ride out and go muster and brumbies
we'll
see. Another few days.
We'll see. Yeah. I've seen this happen before.
You have?
Yep. Yeah, okay, yeah, right. You're
a lot older than me. You're a lot older than me, so you've probably seen a lot more
than
me.
You can call me a but don't call me old.
Okay, right out there, mate.
Yeah.
Well, listen, if I was you, I'd start getting ready. Now, what do I get if I win again? What do I get? What did we bet again? I think it was a whole bottle of Bundaberg rum, wasn't it?
The horse's name is Bundy.
Yeah, I know. I think we need a whole bottle of Bundaberg rum if you lose the bet. What am I paying you?
A carton of Bundy.
A carton of Bundy. Yeah. That doesn't sound like a real good deal to me.
That's a good deal. Yeah, that's a guarantee.
I realise how you got all your money now.
That's
swindling,
a guarantee.
Swindling people like me. I'm on to you.
Good
I'm going to have
mate.
To get a security guard on this horse at night time.
You reckon?
I guarantee you're going to be in here chasing this damn thing around,
well,
whipping it, trying to make it wilder.
Looks like a bit of an old nag at the moment. No, What's going on?
That's what a broke horse looks like. You've been getting on those things that want to bark.
You didn't break its spirit, did you?
Hell no. I brought its spirit out of it. What are you doing, break its spirit?
Oh, God. Look at it.
It
looks like I've got a horse about 25 years old, uses the same stance.
That's because he's broke to death, that's why. Righto, mate. I'll see you tomorrow.
All right, mate. See you later.
Down Under Horsemanship's Australian Outback Adventure has been brought to you by Ritchie Industries. Fresh water for life.
Tomorrow, I want to get him caught, I want to get him saddled, I want to get him used to the saddle, I want to get him flexing a lot better. I want to start preparing him for me as a rider to be on his back. A successful ride is all about preparation. And so far, I couldn't be prouder of him. He's done an excellent job. I think we're gonna beat Ian in his challenge, but he's a tough old You never know what he's up to. He might trick me somewhere in this deal, I don't know. But so far, we're off to a good start, mate.
One of the great things about this is it's so easy to clean. You know, most of the waterers that I've been seeing as I look around with are half barrels cut in half with a floating valve in them.
Yeah.
And they got all this green slime and ugly ooky stuff in them.
Because you can't clean it out.
Because you can't clean it out. And one of the main things about the Ritchie is not only is it tough, but it's extremely easy to clean.
Yeah. Basically, you just poke out the plug, swish it around with your hand, clean it out, put the plug back in, it refills immediately.
That's the animals are going to be able to drink out of it, and they're going to get clean fresh water.